Happy Sabbath to everyone. Indeed, it's my great pleasure to welcome all of you for this Sabbath school service. It is because of God's marvelous guidance we are all being here. I take the privilege once again to welcome you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for the Sabbath school service. Let me read a passage from the Bible. Psalms 112. Verses 1, 2, 3, 4. Praise ye the Lord. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord, that delighteth greatly in his commandments. His seed shall be mighty upon earth. The generation of the upright shall be blessed. Wealth and riches shall be in his house, and his righteousness endureth forever. Unto the upright there arise light in the darkness. He is gracious and full of compassion and righteous. With these wonderful Bible verses, I take the privilege to welcome you again for the SAP school service.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, dear church members. To start our SAP school service, let's all turn our hymn books to hymn number 212. 212. It is almost time for the Lord to come.
Our Heavenly Father, God, we thank you that you took care of us throughout the week. You brought us safely here. Father, we pray for all those who are worshipping throughout this program along us. Give them the same blessings, God. Keep them far from this COVID-19. As you said, your scripture has said, I answer those prayers who come into me and who come in my name. So Father, right now we ask that bless those patients who are carrying this COVID-19 and bless those who are around them. Keep them safe and sound. We pray for all the doctors, nurses, and all the policemen, all the workers, and all the frontliners, God. Be with them, give them the same blessings, give them happiness, health, and be with their families as they take care of our community, they take care of us, our families, our friends. Father, as we pray, that bless them so that they can work more and more for you. We pray for our school in a special way. Be with our principal, sir, and his family. Be with all the administrators, teachers, students, workers, all the parents, and all the well-wishers. Give them the health, strength, and energy, and keep them happy. Keep them far from this disease, God. Bless everyone. We pray that bless your ministries, your health ministries, bless all your churches, your schools, and everything, God. Bless all the leaders of those churches, those health ministries, all the workers, God. Keep guarding angels around everyone. I once again pray that be with each and every one of us. Forgive our sins, God, as we all are sinners. I hand over all of us in your hands. Keep your guarding angels all around us. As we pray in Jesus' name, Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath to each and every one of you. This morning, the mission report comes to us all the way from Poland, and it has been entitled as Two Unexpected Sons. Here, a man named Władysław and his wife named Helena. Helena is 42 years of age and she is almost 5 months pregnant. She decided that she didn't want any more children after giving birth to a third daughter in Poland. And during the same year, she had experience of her first grandchild. The pregnancy alarmed the physician and the physician warned Helena that the child might be disabled due to her age. He also advised her to take an abortion and he also gave her a number of the doctor of whom he can help her during the pregnancy. The physician suggested and gave her a phone number too, and Helena tried calling the number for the appointment, but she got no answer from the doctor. Then giving up on this, she just rushed to her job on her way. Meanwhile, her husband just returned home and heard from his daughter about what all Helena was doing, and she said that this is my decision. I want to have an abortion. Falling on his knees, Władysław pleaded, "Please don't do it." Helena asked whether he would leave her if she had the abortion. He said, "No, no matter what happens, I will never leave you." Helena's heart had been touched by these words. "Okay, let's have this child." And after 3.5 months later, Helena had a healthy baby boy named Adam. For the first time, Helena realized that people can be wrong no matter how strong their opinions are. If God wants to accomplish something, He would fulfill His plans. And then Helena began to wonder why her husband goes to an Adventist church every time. She had never been thought about God in her life any time when she was in the community in the Poland. Then she felt that she has been grateful for that healthy baby that she got from God, and she wanted to do something good for God. So she decided to become an Adventist. Without her husband's knowledge, she started attending the Sabbath lessons and taking Bible study from the pastor. And she surprised her husband, Władysław, by being baptized at the camp meeting. Several years passed, and Helena enrolled at the Adventist seminary in Poland and want to pursue her higher education. And during her classes, she was moved by a word by a man with Down syndrome who speaks about the disabilities and the difficulties of a disabled people. Then she thought to herself that she would write a thesis on how to care for the disabled children. Then a physical therapist, he just introduced a 10-year-old boy named David, and he was an orphanage. And the physician, he just said that He is so unlucky that he had been in the orphanage from his childhood and no family comes to adopt him. Helena joined the government program that allows families to take the orphans home for the weekend. So she and her husband decided to take David on Friday evenings and bring back on Saturday evenings and Sunday evenings. One Sunday evening, David didn't want to come back. He just held the chair and he started crying very loudly. Helena also cried along with her. She decided to adopt David and she decided to make the decision on her own. But she wanted to conclude with her family members. So she announced it in the family meeting when they were having a get together. Everyone opposed her of her decision except her youngest son, Adam, who was 12. After the meeting got over, the youngest son, who is of 12 years of old, named Adam, he just wrote a letter to his parents saying that no matter how David acts, I want him in our family forever. Helena decided to take an early retirement to take care of David. Even though she is in the mid-50s, the court judge just approved her what she was doing. On July 2nd, 2009, David came home. Months after moving in, he had the first operation on his legs. Later, the results of the operation, they disappointed the doctor, and the doctor said that the boy would never walk. Then she thought to herself, if God wanted to accomplish something, he will fulfill his plans. Then after he had the four operations, he can now completely walk successfully. David is 17 and he is now a living witness to God. When the family goes out, people marvel. People ask questions to the families and the family replied them saying by sharing the gospel. They have distributed 200 copies of The Great Controversy in the past years and David loves Bible so much and he has a favorite text and verses in the Bible also. And his favorite chapter, it is Psalms 23, as it sums up his life. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want, he said. Now, the Poland thanks every one of you for the offerings that had helped build a television studio for the Hope Channel and broadcasting the gospel to the Polish-speaking world. Let us now give our tithes and offerings liberally so that we can spread the word of God in every way that we can. Thank you.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. The song that we are singing is entitled as Wonderful Merciful Savior.
Merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a Lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit belong to and rest. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost our way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost our way. You are the one that we hunger for.
Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath. For today's feature talk, I'm going to talk about jackal. Now, what is jackal? Jackal is a sticky liquid that is found under the stomach of a snail, and it has the ability to stick. The jackal is also used in medical supplies like bandages, all adhesive tapes. It's used for all those tapes and all those medical appliances. It sticks to our wound, and it sticks to our wound so firmly that it doesn't come out. When the wound gets dry, when the wound gets healed, it comes out. It has a powerful ability of sticking, and it is called clinging. It has a great ability of clinging. The Bible tells us about a woman named Ruth, who has the same clinging ability, and who sticks her ability and her devotion with her family. In the book of Ruth, it relates that how Ruth and how Orpha, they both were Moabites, how their journey about their family and how they clinched to their family. There was a man named Elimelech and his family. His wife's name was Naomi, and they had two sons. They all were Judeans because they all were Judeans and they lived in Judea. There was a great famine in Judah, and so they had to travel from Judah to Moab. So they had to while they went from Judah to Moab, Elimelech, he died. After his death, the both sons they got married to Orpha and Ruth. After getting married, tragically, they both died. So now Naomi, she got grief struck. She didn't know what to do. So she advised the both of the daughter-in-laws of her. She told them that you go to your families. You go back to your families, and you can stay with your families. I'll go back to my native place. Her native place was Bethlehem. So she said that. So Orpha, she said, okay, I will go back. But then Ruth, she said, no, I will stay with you. And Bible also tells us in Ruth chapter 1 verse 16 that says, wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die. There will I be buried. With this small story of Ruth, we understand that how Ruth has the ability of clinging to her family and have the ability to clinch towards Naomi. The Bible also says that she was the symbol of abiding loyalty and devotion. There is one more great lesson that we can understand from this story is God is concerned about all people regardless of race, nationality or status. Ruth was not a Jew. She was a Moabite, even though many discriminated against her. God loved her just the same. God does not discriminate, and even he loves all the people just the same. Even Ruth was not Israelite. She was not Christian. She was Moabite. But still God loved her the same, and still God didn't leave her alone. So my short, humble request that we should be like Ruth in our lives. When people needs us, when our loved one needs us, we should clinch to them in bad times, in difficult times. We should be with them, and we should be their support. Thank you.
Happy Sabbath to everyone. It's a wonderful blessing that God has given to me to take up the lesson study. And I thank the Lord for the privilege that he has given to me to take the lesson study. The April 25th, Sabbath day that he has given to us. Before we get into the lesson study, let's have a prayer. Loving Father in heaven, thank you so much for being with us. Thank you so much for taking care of us. As we get into the lesson study, O Father, we need your guidance. We need your Holy Spirit to get into the lesson study and to understand. O Father, give us the knowledge and understanding power to go through your words. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I thank the Lord once again for the privilege that has given to me for the lesson study for the date April 25. And the lesson study, this is the second quarter, lesson 4. The title is Bible, the authoritative source of our theology. Let me read once again the lesson 4. Bible, the authoritative source of our theology. And the memory text says, Isaiah 8:20. The memory text is taken from Isaiah 8:20. Let me read. To the law and to the testimony. If they do not speak according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. God has been so good to us during even this terrible situation, the COVID-19, and God has given a privilege to have the church in our home to go through our studies about God. Though our churches are locked down, because that we need to go through and we need to obey the order, and God has been so good to us during this period even to have the privilege to go through the lesson study. And I'm so happy to share some of the things that we have learned from the lesson that has given to us. And there are few things that we need to discuss or we need to study. And thank you so much for giving me this opportunity once again. And let me read again the same Isaiah, the chapter 8, verse 20. To the law and to the testimony, if they do not speak according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. Anyone who speak to the law, not to speak to the law and to the testimony, if they do not speak according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. And when we go through this one, the Sabbath school afternoon, when we just get into the Sabbath school afternoon, the portion, it says there are 5 sources are given to us to study. And Bible, the authoritative source of our theology. There are 5 sources that has given to us to study the theology. And when we come to the conclusion that we have to land up which one is so authoritative source. And the first one, the tradition. And the tradition, of course, we say that the following the past things. The tradition that we have, a human tradition, we follow the past things. And Mark chapter 7, 1 to 13, given to us about how the Pharisees condemn the disciples, the Jesus disciple, about the human tradition. And the passage says about a particular day Jesus and the disciples were coming to a place and were sitting and eating, and some of the disciples were eating the bread without washing the hands. When Pharisees came and see, and they saw that the disciples were eating the bread unwashed hands, so started immediately rebuking them, and they came to Jesus and telling them, see that your disciples are not obeying the tradition of the elders. And Jesus immediately rebuked them and condemned them. You see that you see that you are trying to follow the human tradition rather than the commandment of God. Verse 8 says, Mark chapter 7 verse 8 says, for laying aside the commandment of God, ye hold the tradition of men. Then Jesus immediately condemned them that you are trying to follow the human tradition rather than the commandment of God. And when we try to study the word of God, when we take the word of God, when we study the Bible, or when we get into the God, and we need to see that which source that we are trying to. That is actually the, we sometimes take up our tradition keeping as a source. God says, and Jesus says, and rebuked them. Jesus rebuked them and condemned them. It's not a human tradition. It is the commandment of God. It is the Bible. It is, you have to invite the Holy Spirit to read, to understand the word of God, the Bible. And the second thing, experience. And this week, the lesson study has given to us, there are five sources. The first one is a tradition, and the tradition is not the main source for our theology. It's not the authoritative source of the theology. And because Jesus rebuked them, the experience, what our own personal about God, the experience that we have given to, we have taken our own experience, that is actually, with the experience we may sometimes see that God is like this. We see the view of God with our own experience. And let me just have one passage from the Bible to see that. Matthew 25, chapter 25, verses 14 to 30, it says about the parable of the talent. And Jesus Christ quoted this example to make us to understand that how the people are taking up the view of God, the experience. One man among the three, one man had a different kinds of experience or different view of God. And verse 24 it says, had received one talent and said, Lord, I know thee that thou art hard man. The man who got that one talent and viewing the God in a different way, other two people have the view of God in a different way, and then experiencing in a different way, and this man have the experience with a different way. It is actually that we need to understand in what way that we are viewing the God, the what way that we experience God. And our God is actually the same for everyone, but the problem is actually we experiencing the God in a different way. And it says about, let me read from the lesson study, what we experience significantly shapes our view of God and even our understanding of His word. But we also need to see clearly the limitations and insufficiency of our experiences when it comes to knowing God's will. It's also giving us one more warning, that 2 Corinthians 11 chapter 1 to 3, it says about, it's giving us some kinds of limitations of our experience. So we have to see that when we have the experience about God, we need to take up the view, the what view that we are viewing the God, that experience. And the third one, the third source, culture, the way of life, the way of life around us. When we see our one, everyone have their own particular culture. That culture means they have their own culture and going through. They are following the culture. And God has given us a particular culture. And God has given Israel, say, a particular culture, and they have to follow. God has taught them with the culture. At the first John, second chapter 15-17 says, we should not love the things of the world. It says, we should not love the things of the world. The things is what? Culture. So, the Israel people, ancient Israel people, God taught them a very good culture that they have to follow. But what happened when they see the surrounding people, when see that other culture, they trying to adapt those culture, and they corrupted themselves. They corrupted themselves by seeing the other culture. And even when we take up the Israel's culture, the ancient Israel's culture, they were constantly looking at others. Was what the first John, the second chapter 15-17 says, that we should not love the things of the world. And Mrs. A.G. White also trying to quote that. It says that we have to be in the world, but doesn't mean that we need to be isolated and somewhere to go out of the world. We cannot. We have to be. So, but we have to adapt the culture, and that culture that we need to invite the Holy Spirit, and we need to read the Bible and the Word of God in a proper way to follow the culture. And the fourth source, reason, ability to think. God has given us to think, wisdom and knowledge, and to reason out everything. But when we try to reason out anything, that has to go with the Word of God, the harmony with God, harmony of God, harmony with the Scripture. If it is not going along with God and the Scripture, as the Isaiah 8:20 says, to the law and to the testimony, if they do not speak according to the word, it is because there is no light in them. And if anyone reasoning out the Word of God, or when we are trying to read, or when we are trying to experience God, when we are trying to go through the culture and the tradition, anything that reason out, if they are trying to reason out the Word of God, if it is not going according to the law and the testimony, it says that it is not according to God, and there is no light in them. And before we reason out, if you want to reason out, before we reason out, ask God for wisdom. And how the Proverbs 1 and 7 and 9 and 10 says that fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Fear of the Lord is the beginning of the wisdom. And it says that we need to ask God for the wisdom. We need to ask God for the knowledge to reason out certain things. And it says the one very good example given, Thomas Jefferson, a former president of the USA, once he made his own version of the New Testament. He made his own version of the New Testament, cutting the miracles of God and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He made his own. And Thomas Jefferson, he made his own version. He didn't reason out in a proper way. When we trying to reason out, when we trying to have the source, when we see that the reason, the authoritative source of our theology, it should go with a proper knowledge of God and wisdom of God. And not like Thomas Jefferson, that unlike Thomas Jefferson, that we need to suppose not to be. And the fifth one is the Bible itself. The fifth source is the Bible itself. Ultimately, the Bible is the main authoritative source of our entire theology. And every churches, they have their own theology, though they are reading the Bible. Every church members, they have, all the in the world, any church, any denomination, if they have if they have their own theology, but they have to follow, they are following the Bible. And even if they follow the Bible, their theology is totally different, varies. But the ultimate and very authoritative source among all these sources, that is Bible. When we try to have the tradition, we have to follow the Bible. If the human tradition is not going according to the Bible, there is no light in them. When we take up the experience, the way we view God, if it's not going according to the word of God, our experience, there is no light in them. And then our culture, if the culture is not going according to the word of God, there is no light in them. And when we are trying to reason out anything that the source, the Bible, without the Holy Spirit, without doing that, there is no light in them. It is not the authoritative source for the theology. And ultimately, the Bible itself, the ultimate source. Let me just conclude and by reading this lesson study. Tradition, experience, culture, reason, and the Bible are all present in our reflection on the Word of God. But we need to ask a decisive question. Which of these sources has the final say and ultimate authority in our theology? Which of these sources has the final say and the ultimate authority in our theology? It is one thing to affirm that the Bible, but with the Holy Spirit to impact and change life. Let me say again, it is only one thing, that is Bible. The Bible is the source, ultimate source or authoritative source of our theology. And may God bless us as we have learned the lesson in such a way that this fourth chapter, the title, The Bible, the Authoritative Source of Our Theology, and there are five sources has been given. Among those five, the last one is the Bible itself, that is the greatest and authoritative source of our theology. May God bless each one of us. In order to close our Sabbath school service, let's have the closing prayer. Loving and living Father in heaven, thank you so much for all the mercies and the blessing that you have given to us during the past days, O Father. It's all because of your grace and marvelous guidance that we are able to be here. O Father, on your name, it's a terrible situation that arises, O Father, but it is because of you that we are able to move around. We are able to in safeguard. Thank you so much for the lesson study that you have given to us. Thank you so much for the Sabbath school services which you have given to us, O Father. It's because of your grace and abundant blessing that we are able to get into the Sabbath schools, O Father. It's all because of your grace. Thank you so much for being with us. And we pray that you would be with the rest of the program that is going to be assigned, O Father. And also we pray that you would be with the people, those who are in and around, and especially in these situations. O Father, we pray that you would be with all of us, and especially with the man who is going to preach. O Father, we also pray that you would be with especially our nation, India, during this great, terrible situation. O Father, we thank you so much for being with us, and thank you so much for all the blessing that you have given. Thank you so much for the Sabbath school service and the lesson study. At last, when you are coming in the clouds of heaven, O Father, give us the privilege to get into your kingdom. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, dear church members. For our welcome note, I just want to read from the book of Psalm, chapter 147. And verse 1 and 2 and 3. Psalm 147 verses 1 to 3. Praise ye the Lord, for it is good to sing praises unto our God, for it is pleasant, and praise is comely. The Lord doeth build up Jerusalem, he gathereth together the outcasts of Israel. He healeth the broken in heart, and bindeth up their wounds. With these words of assurance, it is my humble privilege to welcome you all for this divine service of the Sabbath day. God has been so kind and gracious to all of us that the very fact we are inhaling and exhaling the breath of life shows that God is faithful to us even during this global crisis, COVID-19. And as we focus and as we listen to God's word through his servant this morning, I want you to tune up yourself with YouTube or by the means of internet and spend time with the word of God as we listen to the sermon this morning. I have few announcements for the church members and the believers. Kindly pay attention to that. As we all have been locked down in our houses, you might be wondering about your offerings and tithes. Let me tell you, because of this pandemic, I want to encourage as you meet in your houses for worship and as towards your close of your worship, may I request any single member of your family to collect your family offering and tithes and pray over it. Towards the end of my announcement, I would like to offer a prayer over all the offerings which will be collected. But I also would like to encourage that any member of the family can offer a prayer over the offering. Now, the offering is as much as the part of worship. We we worship God with songs, we worship God with our presence, we worship God with the word of God and testimonies, and so also we worship God with our offerings that we have. And so at this time, this is an announcement, I want you to keep that offering with you till the situation settles down. And in the days to come, if the situation takes time to settle, then we will provide the bank account number of the Gujarat conference, through which I know many of us are living in the latest technology. Many of us have Google Pay and Phone Pay and Paytm, through which you are able to deposit right in the bank, and we will make sure that we will make the receipt of your offerings. And so, my dear church members, as you worship the Lord, let us also keep in mind that we need to worship the Lord with our sacrifice and offerings and tithes, because it is as essential as the worship is part of our life. And so may God bless you as you think of this, to worship the Lord with your offerings. The next announcement is the about the measures that the Indian government is taking to stop the spread of COVID-19 in India. I want you to be very serious about these measures. Please teach and educate your little ones not to go out of your houses, not to go and roam around, and also you be safe and spend time with God. Be home, be safe. This is my prayer for all of you. And turn, if you have turn to the vegetarian diet, follow all the principles that we have in the book, in the Bible, regarding our health. I want you to turn to the vegetarian diet, eat healthy and stay healthy. I also would like to tell you about the new start. Follow the new start, eat nutritious food, do your exercise, drink lot of water and take sunlight, and trust in God. That is very important. My dear church members, please take all the measures that the Indian government is asking us to take, and let us be supportive and cooperative to the present government officials. And The third announcement is about the Sabbath worship. Many of us will think that we don't have anybody to see at home whether we are keeping the Sabbath or not. But more than a human eyes, the eyes of God are watching you, because all of us have been given angels, and they are recording everything that we do in this world. And so let us be faithful in regard of the time that God has given to us. Moment by moment and Sabbath after Sabbath, we will meet just like as we are meeting today, and we will have this worship. And pray that nothing will hinder and distract us from reaching out to you and giving you messages from God's word. Pray that nothing will distract us from focusing on God and from focusing on our eternal life. May God continue to bless you and keep you safe as we get into this divine hour, as we seek the Lord during this divine hour. Let me offer a prayer for all of you as you place your offering and collect it and keep it safe for God's glory and His work. Let me pray. Most gracious, loving Father in heaven, at this time, once again, it is our privilege to gather ourselves in our homes with the family members to worship you. And as we get into the divine hour, we would like to pray for the speaker, Lord. We pray that the words of his mouth and the meditation of his heart be acceptable to you, as he inspires all those who are listening and watching us, O Father. We pray that you fill him with your spirit, you fill him with your words, and let there be a clarity of thought, O Father. We also would like to pray for the people who have shown themselves faithful in giving tithes and offerings, and those who are not able to give, Father, may you bless them and help them understand the significance of giving. Father in heaven, as you have promised us that there will be no place in our houses to accommodate your blessings, and may we experience, Lord, by giving what belongs to you. Lord in heaven, I pray for the believers who have given the offerings. Bless the offering, may it multiply, may the double portion of your blessing rest upon it, and may it be utilized for your glory and the expansion of the gospel work. Dear Father in heaven, at this time, I would like to ask you that you will strengthen us to be faithful to you even in this time of crisis. Lord in heaven, be with each and every one of us as we listen and watch your servant speaking to us, Father. Bless him, guide him, and hide him under your wings, that he will speak from your word and what you want him to speak. Dear God in heaven, be with us and guide us, because these few blessings we ask in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
I take this privilege to welcome you all for the divine service. Let me read the passage from the Bible, Psalms 46, verses 1 to 7. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved, and shall help her, and that right early. The heathen ragged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. With this, a wonderful passage, that I take the privilege once again to welcome you all for the divine service. And may God bless each one of us as we get into the divine service during this great and terrible situation, the COVID-19, And also I thank our government that taking the wonderful steps to protect all of us and to take care of the India, our nation. God bless them too, and God be with them always.
To begin our divine service, our opening song will be hymn number 470, There's Sunshine in My Soul Today, 470.
Sunshine in the soul, there's music in my soul today, a carol to my King, and Jesus listening can hear the songs I cannot sing. Oh, there's sunshine, blessed sunshine, the peaceful, happy moments roll. When Jesus shows His smiling face, there is sunshine in the soul. There is springtime in my soul today, for when the Lord is near, the dove of peace sings in my heart, the flowers of grace appear. Oh, there's sunshine, blessed sunshine, when the peaceful, happy moments roll. When Jesus showed His smiling face, there is sunshine in the soul. There is gladness in my soul today, and hope and praise and love. For blessings peace He gives me now, for joys laid up above. Oh, there's sunshine, blessed sunshine, when the peaceful, happy moments roll. When Jesus shows His smiling face, there is sunshine in the soul.
For our scripture reading, the speaker has chosen from the book of Jonah, 3rd chapter, 6 to 8 verses. I am reading from King James Version. For word came unto the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, and he laid his robe from him, and covered him with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. He caused it to be proclaimed and published through Nineveh by the decree of king and his nobles, saying, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Let them not feed nor drink water, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth, and cry mightily unto God. Hey, let them turn every one from his evil way, and from the violence that is in their hands. May God bless this scripture that is being read.
Shall we close our eyes and bow our heads as we seek the Lord in prayer? Let's pray. Our Father which art in heaven, we thank the Lord for giving us this opportunity where we could come into your presence to seek your blessings. We come to Thee on this Holy Sabbath day with our hearts filled with gratitude and thanksgiving for the bountiful blessings that You have bestowed upon each one of us. We thank Thee for all Thy mercies and care and protection that You have so graciously granted to each one of us, for the good health and strength that we enjoy. And we pray that You would continue to lead us and guide us. Dear Lord, we are sinners. We pray that You would forgive all our sins and shortcomings. Accept us as we are. And we know that You are a merciful and loving God, and because of which You have sent Your only begotten Son to die on our behalf so that we may have this salvation. And therefore, dear Lord, we pray that You would bless each one of us. In a very special way, we pray that You would be with all the members that are in their respective homes, who have joined us to worship Thee and to meditate upon Your word this morning. We pray that You would be with each one of them and bless each family that is represented. We pray that You would be with each one of them, continue to lead them and guide them in all their ways. If there are any sick amongst them, we pray that You would stretch forth Your healing hand upon them and bring them to normal health and strength. Dear Lord, the whole world is in turmoil because of this virus. And we know that we are living in the last days of the earth's history. And during this time of trouble that You have promised us, call unto Me during the time of trouble, and I will deliver Thee and glorify Thee. With this promise, dear Lord, we pray that You would listen to our supplications. And we thank Thee for the schools that You have established in Ahmedabad, both Nikhol as well as in Maninagar. And we pray that You would be with all the teachers. We pray that You would be with all the parents, the students, and the administration in a very special way. As we go through this troubled time, we pray that You would bless each one of us. We pray that You would protect each one of us and guide us and guard us through this perilous times. In a very special way, we remember the frontline workers that are sacrificing their time in order to serve the humanity. And we pray that You would be with all the doctors and the nurses and all the health workers that are coming out during this time. We pray that You would protect them from all harm and danger. We also remember all the other workers that go from door to door selling vegetables and other essential goods. We also remember the stores that are open during this time. May each one of them, as they fulfill their desires of their hearts, we pray that You would bless each one of them, protect them from all harms and dangers. If there are any one that is disheartened because of this lockdown, we pray that You would strengthen them with Thy love, with Thy blessings. In a very special way, we pray that You would be with the speaker of this hour. As he is going to deliver the message, we pray that You would touch him, touch his lips, so that the message that comes to us will be from Thy throne of grace. Touch our hearts and open our minds so that we may be receptive to the message. And as we live in this world, may we remember that it is by Your grace and by Your love that we are alive today. And therefore, dear Lord, we pray that you would not cast us away from your presence, but that you would deliver each one of us. Forgive all our sins and shortcomings once again, and be with us throughout this day and the days to come, because we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
One by one, Jesse's sons stood before the prophet. The father knew a king would soon be found. Each one passed, except the last. No one thought to call him, for surely he would never wear a crown. But when others see a shepherd boy, God might see a king. Even though your life seems filled with ordinary things, just a moment he can touch you, and everything will change. When others see a shepherd boy, God might see a king. One by one, problems come, dreams get shattered. Sometimes it's hard to understand. Things like change and circumstance, they don't really matter. The Father holds tomorrow in his hands. But when others see a shepherd boy, God might see a king. Even though your life seems filled with ordinary things, just a moment and he can touch you, and everything will change. When others see a shepherd boy, God might see a king. Well, he wasn't the oldest, he wasn't the strongest, chosen on that day. And yet giants fell and nations trembled, they stood in his way. And when others see a shepherd boy, God might see a king. Even though your life seems filled with ordinary things, just a moment he can touch you, and everything will change. When others see a shepherd boy, God might see a king. God might see a king.
Greetings to you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The Lord has been so kind, so merciful for us all these days. The world is going in a tremendous dangerous hours. but the Lord has been kind to us. Today I want to present a message. The hour has come. The hour has come. For what? For what the hour has come? If you go to the book of Revelation, it is talking about the three angels' message. The hour has come. Here, John the Revelator is sitting in the island of Patmos, and God has shown him the revelation that is going to happen in the last days. Yes, he had seen. That's why he wrote, "The hour has come." These are the words of the angels. And what is the hour that has come for us? Each and every one of us need to be on our knees. This is the hour that has come to us to be on our knees. As I said, the world is facing a dangerous days where we cannot escape if the Lord's protection is not there on us. The government is telling, be inside, don't come out. Yes, the Lord has instructed during the time of Egyptians, the Israelites should not come out. And those who came out, they lost their life. The Indian government has taken a lot of measures to save us. The government is loving us. The government loves the Indians. That's why they have taken tremendous measures to save us. And we are the people of this country as God has created us. As God has created us, He loved us. That's why if you go to the book of Exodus, chapter 32, verse 19 and 14, where it is clearly said, because the people of Israel turned away from God and they don't want to obey God's word, they don't want to listen to God's word. And the Lord is telling to Moses, I have seen these people and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. Are we so? That's why the Lord said to Moses, these people are stiff-necked people and I want to destroy them. But the prophet, the great leader, and on the whole world, we see that Moses is having the patience, the man of patience. He went and knelt before the Lord and said, Lord, if you want to kill these people of Israelites, kill me first. That's what Moses said. If you want to kill these people, blot out my name away from the book of life. And if you go further, where it says on the 14th, and the Lord relented from the disaster, and he had spoken to bring on his people. That means the Lord taken back his word where he decided to kill his people, but now he did not want to kill. Why? Because a prophet, the man of God, was on his knees, who loved the humanity, was on his knees and is pleading the Lord, please do not kill them. That's the power of human beings. God has given us the time. God has given us 40 days of lockdown. For what? Not to roam on the roads, not to be here and there. We need to be in our rooms. We need to kneel down and come to God. This is the time that we need to shed our tears, pray and cry unto the Lord. Oh Lord, please hear. Oh Lord, please hear. This is what we need to do. Moses did the same thing. Then let us see one more prophet. One more prophet. Many times we pray and we ask God and we don't wait until God answers us. We don't wait and immediately we want to jump. And here is a prophet. We see that. Let us turn our book to the book of 1 Kings chapter 18 verse 43. And here it says, and he said to his servant, go up now, look towards the sea. Elijah, the great prophet, after bringing down
the fire from heaven. He had the power from God to shut down the sky without rain for 3.5 years. Then now he wanted to see that people again back in joy, in happiness. And he prayed to God and he wanted to bring back the rain down. That's why here he is telling to King Ahab, now God is going to bring rain back again to this earth. Be prepared, he said. He knelt down, he put his head between the knees. The word of God says that the same thing. He put his head between his knees and try and asking the Lord and praying to the Lord, Lord, send the rain back. And he sent the servant, look towards the sea. And he went up and looked and said, there is nothing. The servant came back and said, Master, I didn't see anything. There is nothing. But he did not stop there. He did not got vexed to pray again. Again he prayed and sent his servant, go and see if there anything is there. Again the servant went. And here it says, and he said, go again 7 times. The servant went and saw 7 times. And if you go to the next verse, the book of 1 Kings, chapter 18, verse 14, where it says, and at the 7th time he said, behold, a little cloud like a man's hand is rising from the sea. Pray, pray, pray without ceasing. Now we are facing all these problems, and what is our duty to do it? And what we need to do it? We need to be on our knees. Ask, 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 and plead God. Oh Lord, we beseech thee to protect us, to protect our land, to protect our country, to protect our family. And as Elijah prayed 7 times, and here we see that on the 7th time, the servant could able to see a small cloud. He came on the 7th time and said, oh Master, I could able to see a small cloud rising from the sea. It is like the size of the hand of a man. Oh, what a joy they got. God heard the man prayed. God heard the prayer of Elijah. He prayed, and God again, once again, he wanted to open the sky and bring back the rain down. That's what we need to do. We need to pray. We need to ask God to protect us from these perilous days, from the deadly virus, from the deadly disease, from the deadly pestilence. We need to ask God. If we don't ask God, what's going to happen? The government is telling, don't go out. And some are telling, no, we want to go out. We are seeing in WhatsApp, we are seeing in cameras, we are seeing in the TVs how people are dying. We need to obey. The hour has come. The hour has come for Elijah to answer to God and to ascend to heaven. And his servant is came. Elisha came and Elijah asked him, what do you want me to do? See here what he's telling. I want the double portion of the blessings. If a servant comes to the master and asks, you give me the double portion of your blessings, what the master thinks? Here, the master did not see anything, did not feel anything. And here, it got in his mind, maybe Elisha is asking for the double portion in order to expand the work, in order to do the double work. So he answered, when I go up, if God answers, if God pleases your question or your answer, if he answers you, if God desires the desire of your heart, he may give you. And as it is said, Elisha received the double portion of blessings from heaven. And here we see in the book of 2 Kings, chapter 4, verse 18 and 19. While Elisha was going here and there every day in the Shunammite, where a lady saw the Shunammite called her husband and said, "See, my dear, this man of God, every day he's going this way, why not we make a room for him?" Husband agreed, because this is a man of God, and they made a room on the upper side. And every day Elisha used to come, where the lady arranged a bed for him, a table for him, a lamp for him, so that he can come, study and preach and lay down and go. So after some days, Elisha asked his servant, asked this lady, why, what she needed. And she called the lady and she asked the Shunammite lady, "Shall I go and request something to the king about you?" The lady said no. And the servant came to know that the lady don't have any children. And he said, "Master, they're old. They don't have any children. Her husband is old." But Elisha said, "By next time, by the same season, you're going to have a child." The lady laughed. "You are a man of God. You're a man of God. Why are you lying? Why are you telling lies? My husband is old. How can I get a child? Is there anything impossible to God?" "No. There is nothing impossible to God. Everything is possible to God. God can do anything when he shut down the sky without rain. And when he heard the prophets prayed, and here he could able to do. By next year he got a child, and the child grew." Here in the book of 2 Kings chapter 4 verse 18 and 19, when the child had grown, he went out one day to his father among the reapers, and he said to his father, Oh my head, that means he got headache and he was about to die. And the father called the servants, "Take this lad to the mother." And when they carried the child to the mother carried the child, but the child passed away. The child died. And immediately she ran to Elisha. He is sitting on the mountain. She is running there, and Elisha saw, and where he called his servant, "Go, that lady is coming. You go and find out, is everything well with her husband, with her son?" By the time the lady came and said, "I didn't request you to give a child, but you have given me child. What you have brought to me? My son had died." Oh, immediately Elisha said, oh, he called his servant. And here we can see in the book of 2 Kings chapter 4 verse 29. And he said to Gehazi, "Tie up your garment and take my staff in your hand and go. If you meet anyone, do not greet him. If anyone greet you, do not reply, and lay my staff on the face of the child." Yes. Did Gehazi obey? Yes, the servant obeyed. He took the staff and he ran. He did not stop anywhere. And here we see here, when the authority is telling us something and we don't want to obey it, we want to go against it, and we face the consequences. Here, Elisha asked his servant, "Do not greet anybody. Even if anybody greets you, you don't greet." That's what we are doing now. If anybody shake hand, we should not shake hand. If anyone want to argue, you don't want to hug, because it's an order from the government. And here, Elisha is ordering his servant, "Do not greet anybody. Even if they greet also, don't greet. Directly take this rod and put on the child." Yes, that's what the servant did. And afterwards, he came back and said, "Master," the child did not get up. In the next verse, we can see here, 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 33. So he went and shut down the door behind the two of them and prayed to the Lord. Elisha himself went in order to bring the life back to this child. Is it possible? Yes, my dear church members, it is possible. As my dear believers, it is possible with God. Elisha went, he shut down the door, and he asked the lady to go away. Shut down the door. He saw the dead child, He knelt down there and prayed and asked the Lord, "Oh Lord, give life back to this child." The child did not get up. And again, Elijah went, prostrated himself over the child, and again came down and prayed. Like that he prayed. And afterwards, we see that life came back to this child. That is the power of our living God. That is the power of our living God. He has given the power to humanity. When we come to his feet, when we plead him, he has everything. And here we can see one more thing. How God is answering. How God is answering the people. When the hour of time comes for us to be on our knees. And when we are on your knees, God is hearing our prayer. And here we see one more. The book of Isaiah chapter 38 verse 2. Then Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord. That's what here it says. Israel got the deadly wound and he was about to die. God sent Isaiah, go and tell Hezekiah that he is going to die and let him arrange his house. That Hezekiah turned towards the wall. He humbled himself. He humbled himself. Though he is king, he humbled himself, turned towards the wall and prayed and asking the Lord, "Lord, you know what kind of life I lived. Oh Lord, you know how I did. How I obeyed you." And he prayed to the Lord and the Lord answered Hezekiah's prayer. The Lord answered Hezekiah's prayer. And you are kneeling and praying. We are kneeling and praying. And when our prayers are not answered, how long we are waiting upon the Lord? We need to have patience so that our prayers will be answered. And Hezekiah's prayer is answered. And again, God sent Isaiah. Tell him that I'm going to increase another 15 years of lifespan for you. He went and told. That's what he did. And if we see how the people of Nineveh are living. The people of Nineveh are wicked people. God asked Jonah to go. Yes, Jonah went. Afterwards, by facing the Lord's consequences, he was on the land of Nineveh. And he preached for the people. He preached for the people. He said, "You are wicked. God is going to destroy your land. God is going to destroy your land. Come down to your knees. The hour has come for you to confess your sins. Now you have to be on your knees. You confess your sins. Come before the Lord and pray so that the Lord will save your country." Yes. And here he sees the book of Jonah chapter 3 verse 6 and 8. 6 to 8 we see that the word reached the king of Nineveh. And he arose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, sat in ashes. Who? The king, the king, the king himself came down and he proclaimed in his country from higher to the lowest level, the last level, and every man with his beast and the fowls, nobody should drink. Everybody should come down, cover the sackcloth and ask the Lord and plead the Lord. Ask the Lord, plead the Lord, request the Lord so that the Lord will hear and save our country. Are we able to do that now? Are we doing? Because the government has given us the time to be on our knees. It is the time that God permitted. God permitted this and we got this one. Are we on our knees? The people of Nineveh knelt down before the Lord and cried and prayed. And where it says the Lord has relented and he did not destroy Nineveh. The Lord did not destroy Nineveh, my dear people. If we pray, if we ask, if we cry and ask the Lord to protect, we are here. Our children may be somewhere. And how we are spending our time? Are we spending our time in the prayer? And we are seeing in the TVs how the husband is at one place, the wife is at another place, the children are another place, the parents are another place. They are crying. There is nothing to do. They cannot do anything even if they die. My dear members, my dear church members, now I ask, I plead every one of you, Let us be on our knees. Let us be on our knees so that we can be saved from this deadly virus, from this pestilence. And I want to tell one more thing here. If you see the book of 1 Kings chapter 19 verse 3, we have heard that God heard Elijah and he shut down the sky without rain for 3.5 years. And again God sent the rain. He has seen everything, and he had witnessed that God sent the fire from heaven to consume the altar and all the sacrifice on that. He had seen after seeing everything. Now Ahab's wife Jezebel, he sent a word to Elijah, I'm going to kill you, you are going to die like other people. See this, what happened after tasting all the power of God, after seeing the power of God, after tasting the love of God, Elijah wanted to run away, forgetting God. Are we doing the same thing? After seeing all these things, are we forgetting God? And here we see, then he was afraid and he rose and ran for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. Did he stop there? No. He left his servant there and he ran and ran for his life. The angel came and wished, oh, my dear members, are we running away like that? Are we running away like that? In the last, I want to all of you to come to this Revelation, the book of Revelation, chapter 14, verse 7 to 9. As we have seen, and he said with a loud voice, fear God and give him glory, because the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made heaven and earth and the sea and the spring of waters. That's what the message comes to us today. And here we can see the Italian Prime Minister. We have lost control. Can't understand what more we can do. All solutions are exhausted on the ground. And our only hope remains in the sky. God, rescue your people. This is what the Italian Prime Minister is pleading. We can see him. We can see how he cried. We all witnessed. We are safe in our houses. We are safe in our houses. The lands are perishing. Countries are perishing. And today the verse comes to us. Fear God and give him glory. The hour of his judgment has come. If today is the judgment for you and for me, what we need to do? We have to be on our knees. We have to fear the Lord. When we fear the Lord, definitely Lord is going to save you and me. When we on our knees, when we realize the hour has come for us to be on our knees and plead God, to ask God to protect us. Yes, definitely the Lord is going to protect us. Not only us, we will be protected, and our government will be protected, our country will be protected. May God help all of us. May God help all of us and protect us from this deadly virus and from all the pestilence, from the sinful life. God bless you all.
To bring our divine service to a close, we will sing hymn number 444. I'm a pilgrim. 444.
I'm a pilgrim and I'm a stranger. I can tarry but a night. Do not detain me, for I am going to where the fountains are ever flowing. I'm a pilgrim and I'm a stranger. I can tarry but a night. There's the glory is ever shining. Oh, my longing heart is there. Here in this country, so dark and dreary, I long have wandered for long and weary. I'm a pilgrim and I'm a stranger. I can tarry but a night. There's the city
to which I journey. My Redeemer is its light. There is no sorrow, nor any sighing, nor any tears there, or any dying. I'm a pilgrim, and I'm a stranger. I can tarry, but the night.
Dear church members, here is the time for us now to close our eyes, to be on our knees. And let us all pray. While I'm praying, I request every one of you to pray in your heart, in your mind, and plead the Lord to protect us from all the harm and danger. Let's pray. Lord God Almighty, thank you for the beautiful hour to listen to thy word. And we have received the right message that we need to come to thy feet, to be on our knees and to cry unto thee. O Lord, we are sinners. Forgive all our sins and shortcomings. Wash us and cleanse us from all our sinful nature, from all our guilt and iniquity. And hear our praise at this time, Lord. And I pray for all the Adventist families around the world. I pray for the present, our church and the school families, the conference families, Lord. Let thy grace, let thy mercy be there upon each and every one of us. Let there be peace. Let there be protection in all the houses. There should not be any disaster in any of our houses, Lord. And I pray for all the sick and suffering. Touch them, heal them, Lord. Open the gates of heaven. Stretch forth thy healing hand and heal them. Heal everybody, Lord. And we pray for the government, Lord. Give them the right mind to lead the nation according to thy will. And we pray for every state and every person, every government leader. Bless them, bless their families. Especially we pray for the police force, Lord. Bless them, bless their families. We pray for the doctors and their families. Bless them, Lord. We pray for everyone who is supporting all the people in this time, during this time, Lord. Thank you for hearing all our prayers. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.